Excuse me, sir. Do you have a moment to talk about our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ?
All too often, apologists can come across like salesmen.
I wonder, would I be willing to stand before God on the judgment day and God were to say to me, why didn't you believe in me? And I would say, well, because I thought the universe might have popped into being uncaused out of nothing. I think God would look at me and say, you what? I'm just not prepared to do that sort of thing. Are you?
Right. But I reject that imagery, right? I don't think that's what by denying the causal principle, I don't think that's what is entailed by it. That seems wrong to me, right?
Leading to agitation and eye rolling, at least for those who are paying attention. But why is this? Why do they sometimes come across like salesmen? Well, because they sometimes use various strategies to manipulate people. And it's frustrating. I honestly don't understand how it's not also frustrating for the people doing it sometimes.
So just like that, huh?
Yep, why wait when we could get you rolling?
You were gonna take some time though and consider your options, but I just come in and do that little song and dance and I'm in.
Yeah, right, that's right.
Are you out of your mind? You don't know me. I just came in off the street. You guys are like a couple of cats. I come in, wave a shiny object around. You're like, I want that. No due diligence, no background check. No, just hire the guy that says them fancy words. I could be a serial killer. I could be a guy who pees in your coffee pot. I could be both.
So you're not taking the job?
No, I'm not taking the job.
Suckers.
Regardless of the motives that cause people to act like this, in this video, I'm going to give you 6 ways that apologists can manipulate you. The first is overemphasizing irrelevant credentials.
In other words, it's like my cold cases. That gives me a point of context, a point of reference to begin an investigation. But for me, just my gut instinct as an investigator, and that's the beautiful thing about Christianity, is it's something you can actually investigate. I'm grateful for that because as an investigator, that's exactly how I came to faith.
Look, I'm not saying we don't all have unique perspectives to bring to the table when offering our conversion and deconversion stories. I'm not even saying our occupation can't contribute to that. I'm just saying, who really f***ing cares that he was a cold case detective? Given the fact that most philosophers, biblical scholars, and historians think that many of the claims made by evangelicals are just downright stupid, it seems like they're grasping at straws to platform anyone who might be able to give people a false sense of authority, even though the individuals in question have no training in any of the relevant areas. And if you think being a detective is super relevant here, how many examples might there be of detectives who started out as evangelical Christians, but then lost that kind of faith along the way? Wouldn't it be interesting to hear their stories, Christians? Moving on to number 2. Carefully working to control the narrative. In the aftermath of 9/11, there was a wave of vocal atheism and criticism that the religious elite were not used to. Someone described this as a new atheism, and the term stuck and has been heavily propagated in religious circles ever since. The initial wave of this criticism was not always as informed as it could be, and didn't show religious people the deference and respect they were used to receiving. So, of course, they tried to mock back and create stereotypes of vocal atheists and skeptics. But the thing is, vocal atheism and/or skepticism has come a long way since the prime of Dawkins, Dennett, Hitchens, and Harris. But I think you'll notice, if you pay attention, that the many apologetic strategies remain the same. Anyone who criticizes religion directly and with any force is often still stereotyped as a Reddit atheist living in their mom's basement with their fingerless glove collection, regardless of how informed that person is on the relevant issues. Why? Because it was never really about making fun of the initial new atheists for their lack of insight. It was about spinning a narrative to protect an uncertain flock. That's why the playbook hasn't changed, even though the representatives of thoughtful skepticism have. Related to narrative control, You'd think the way that some apologists engage would lead you to believe that they're running Jesus' personal PR campaign.
I generally try and be a good person, so, but I don't believe in a Christian God. Do you think I'm going to hell?
What do you mean by being a good person?
The correct answer on Turek's theology is yes. If you do not repent and turn to Jesus, you are going to hell. But he can't bring himself to be direct about what he really believes.
Do you think I'm going to hell? It's not what I have to...
Well, I don't think God is going to force anybody into heaven against their will.
Do you think I'm going to burn for all eternity?
Well, it depends on what you mean by burn, because...
So do you think that I'm going to hell?
I think I'm going to hell.
I think I'm going to hell without Jesus, so... But enough about carefully curated narrative control. A third way apologists can manipulate you is to present themselves as more well-read and informed than they actually are. Here's a funny example where What Do You Meme is trying to respond to genetically modified skeptic.
If God couldn't create a food cycle for all creatures that didn't include suffering, then he isn't omnipotent. If he didn't know the system would lead to suffering, he isn't omniscient. Now, if he could have done better, if he could have made a food cycle that didn't promote suffering, but chose not to, he's not only lacking in omnibenevolence, but I would argue he's a sadist.
This is what kind of reveals to me more that Drew probably isn't familiar with the biblical literature, because it seems to ignore the fact that God did create a food cycle that didn't include suffering, right? We all know this. And then the fall happened, and then that's what changed the world. The world was initially created with harmony.
So to counter Drew's point, John gets on his high horse and with all of his amazing knowledge and intellectual prowess declares that Drew is simply uninformed. All the while, acting like the position he just sketched out was the Christian with a capital C position.
People who claim to be Bible-believing Christians actually are reading things into the text that are not there. Namely, the idea that there was not animal death and pain prior to the fall of man.
It's almost like, at the time he said this at least, he didn't even have a basic grasp of the lay of the land. That example aside, you won't have to look very far to see apologists betray their lack of knowledge on certain topics by just listening to how they talk about them, all the while acting like their opponents are the ones who are uninformed. Number four, turning doubt into self-doubt. If you're a Christian watching this, you've probably been trained to turn any serious doubts you have about the truth of Christianity into self-doubt. What I mean is, you've been trained to think that the root cause of your questioning can't really be that there's something wrong with Christianity. It's that there's something wrong with you. But if you allow your bullshit detector just a little bit of room to breathe, I think you should be able to see that you would be immediately suspicious if you notice groups you disagreed with utilizing this strategy on their members. Most of you are going to call that cult tactics, apart from any honest introspection about how your communities actually work. Number five, creating sharp binaries. Did you know that either the omni-god exists or reductive materialism is true? That if Christianity is true, the Bible has to be inerrant? Well, neither of those things are true, actually. There are all kinds of options available to both theists and atheists. As a theist, you could believe in a limited creator. You could believe in a traditional god, but think no world religion is true. You could be a Christian without going down the fundamentalist route that many apologists travel down. Even for an atheistic naturalist, there are options. As Felipe Leon explains, quote, "There are several versions of naturalism. Naturalists share in common the view that the natural world is all there is. However, naturalists differ in how they define the natural world. Now, there are at least three broad ways of characterizing the natural world, and thus, there are at least three kinds of naturalists. Let's call them conservatives, moderates, and liberals. Conservative naturalists are straight physicalists. Nothing exists but the physical. And the physical is characterized by all and only the properties of a completed physics, and perhaps chemistry, if chemistry cannot be reduced to physics. By contrast, moderate naturalists differ from conservative naturalists in that they expand their conception of the natural world so as to include abstract objects. For example, propositions, properties, possible worlds, etc. Finally, liberal naturalists differ from moderates and conservatives in that they not only admit into their ontology of the natural world the abstracta of the moderates, but they also allow for concreta that have more properties and powers than the conservatives and moderates allow. Unquote. And finally, there is sometimes a subtle attempt to link your confidence in theism with your confidence to specific religious claims, when there isn't really that much warrant for tying them drastically together. So the idea is to try to get you to be really sure about theism, and then try to get you to transfer that confidence into other areas. Sure, theism boosts the probability that, say, Christianity is true somewhat. But the idea that having confidence in the proposition God exists should grant one great confidence in the propositions of, say, the Apostles' Creed strains credulity. Okay, so those are six ways that apologists can manipulate you. Atheists are capable of doing some of these things too. Sure they are, but I don't see it nearly on the scale that theists do it in these spaces. So if that's your objection, then get your own house in order. But wait, you might say. Well, there's a thin line between manipulation and persuasion, you could argue. Apologists are merely trying to persuade their audience, not manipulate them. I agree that persuasion isn't inherently bad. But even if that's the motive, I would argue that the specific kinds of things I just mentioned don't really seem like above-board attempts at persuasion to me. If you think one or more of them are, then I guess we'll just have to agree to disagree. But do you see what I just did there? I told you that it was okay for you to agree to disagree with me about something. This is something many apologists cannot do in many areas, revealing a surprising reason to doubt Christianity. Tap this video next to me to see what I mean.